Philippe Moinjon, good afternoon. Christian Neri, too. And we have Nathalie Sibylle from Montpellier. Are you online? Yes, hi.
Yes, good afternoon.
Okay, so we are all three together to talk about a transversal vision of artificial intelligence in support of drug development for autoimmune disease, as I said. And to understand exactly what's at stake, I will let the floor to Philippe Moinjon first. You have a presentation, and the three of you will have a few slides to help us understand your connection and this transversal vision. And Philippe Moinjon, you're head of immunoinflammation at Servier, a very French famous big pharma. So I let you the floor now.
Thank you very much, Fabrice. And it's my pleasure, actually, to introduce this topic. This is actually a very important topic. We believe that this is a revolution because we have clearly some signs that indeed there will be some impact of artificial intelligence in drug discovery. In fact, a year ago, there was a publication in Cell reporting on the identification of a new antibiotic using artificial intelligence. On my side, I will represent the perspective of the pharmaceutical industry, and I will tell why I think we should really take this extremely seriously. I will, at the end of my presentation, to make things more concrete, illustrate, you know, what we're trying to do to better understand autoimmune diseases, and in fact, our focus is on lupus, as you can see, and on Sjögren. Now, you're all aware of the challenge that we face within the pharmaceutical industry. The timelines and the costs have been on the rise, on the constant rise, in the last decades, and also the attrition rate is just really frightening. As a matter of fact, if you take a drug candidate, that is a molecule that went through discovery, chances is that only 6% of those will make it to registration and thus would be made available to the patient. So this is the challenge we have to face, and clearly this is where artificial intelligence can be very helpful in many, many regards. I will try to define artificial intelligence, and in fact, I think there is two ways to do that. The first one is technological. It's a convergence of technologies, which in fact recapitulates some dimensions of human intelligence. The first one is sensing. We are talking about technologies that can capture and or produce or and transmit information, data. And in fact, after that, we have thinking technologies, and those technologies relate obviously to computational analytics. It's about making models from those data. And then those models can be used to educate specific and appropriate actions, whether it be from humans or from the standpoint of robots. And then we have the part about machine learning. Machine learning is extremely important because it means that intelligent machines can capture additional data and refine their models, and thus it makes the whole process an iterative cycle, and this is very interesting. First definition, technologies. Second definition of artificial intelligence, and I would say in one sentence, it's about capturing the value of massive data, massive amount of data, to educate a decision. And this is very, very important. And in fact, this is, I think, the way we should approach artificial intelligence as it relates to drug development. This is a pretty busy slide, but if you focus on the bottom part, you can see that I have identified a few important decisions that we have to make all along drug development. For example, we need to select the proper therapeutic target. That's one part. We need obviously to select as well a valid drug candidate. We need also to choose a proper dosing regimen. We need to identify the patients that we want to include in our clinical studies. So we have many, many decisions to make. And in this regard, it's interesting those days to build up predictive models that will educate, that will inform those decisions. And in fact, we do so by using sets of data, and I have shown some of those here for illustration purposes. So I guess one way to look at the previous slide as well is to say that in many ways, artificial intelligence is going to be useful all along the drug development process. But I still believe it's interesting for clarity to try to regroup those applications in four categories. The first one is, as you can see on the left-hand side, disease modeling. It means using those technologies to have a better representation and better understanding of those diseases, of their complexity, their heterogeneity. And then from this information, we can go further and try to understand the dysregulated molecular pathways, which are important in causing the disease. And from there, obviously, identifying therapeutic targets. From those informations, we can then obviously use AI to design, to synthesize, to optimize new drugs, new chemical entities or biologicals. We can also use AI to predict some of their features, for example, ADMET properties. And obviously, that's extremely important to increase the productivity of the discovery part. And last but not the least, there is the application to demonstrating clinical efficacy of drugs. And whether it be from massive real data, real world data, when the drug is being marketed, or in the context of clinical studies, and maybe at one point having some virtual clinical studies. Now, what we are doing at Servier, more specifically, to illustrate what I've just said, is we focus on lupus and Sjögren, two complex diseases, and I won't go into the details, but the symptoms can really differ between patients and can affect multiple organs. And in this context, 3 years ago, we undertook a I would say, significant molecular profiling effort of literally thousands of patients with those autoimmune diseases, obviously in comparison with healthy individuals. And we did so in the context of European consortia, that is in a collaborative effort with other companies plus academic groups. And obviously we're talking here about applying what we call the multiomics, transcriptomics, metabolomics, proteomics. As we work in immunology, deep immunophenotyping is an important component, GWAS. Also a lot of clinical data, because we are following those cohorts sometimes for multiple years, looking at disease severity, progression. So a lot of data and in fact massive and multimodal data, as you can see, which, by the way, we supplement constantly by information coming from the scientific literature. And this is where we need the power of artificial intelligence to digest, you might say, to integrate those big chunks of data. And from this, we start to model diseases of interest. How do we do that? Well, first of all, we regroup those patients with lupus, for example, in subsets of patients sharing, I would say, common molecular dysregulations. In fact, we're trying to build up, I would say, fairly homogeneous subgroups of patients based on biological information. And this is really a move towards a classification in what we call endotype. It's a representation of the heterogeneity of the disease. And from there, applying algorithms such as Ingenuity pathway analysis, we can identify those dysregulated pathways in selected or in each of those subgroups or clusters of patients. And this information, as you can easily imagine, is very useful for us to think about many, many therapeutic interventions which are figured out on the right-hand side. I won't go through those various therapeutic approaches, but I want to emphasize precision medicine. In fact, all of this is really heading towards one direction, which is based on a sophisticated understanding and characterization of the patient population. We are now, and we will be more so in the future, in a position to design and apply drugs to those specific subsets of patients more likely to benefit from it. Lastly, I want to allude to another type of analysis, which we call network computing. And this is really an attempt to represent the disease as an interactome. This is how we call it, an interactome of genes or proteins, it could be proteins as well, which we believe are very, very important in the pathophysiology of the disease. We believe that this is a representation of the causality of the disease. And in fact, if you look on the central panel on this slide, you have here one such an interactome figuring out what is happening in the salivary gland of patients with Sjögren. In this disease, there is an immune destruction of salivary glands, and we believe that this is the molecular interactions which are at play underlying the disease. And as you can see, we are able to predict what we call master regulators, that is genes which are very, very important to regulate many other genes causing the disease. And in fact, even with the computing analysis, we can predict which type of influence they have on those other genes, whether down-regulating or whether activating other genes. And in fact, as you can imagine, this is extremely important to identify, interesting therapeutic targets. Also, it's a new way to represent the disease. In fact, what we have to treat is a biological system which causes the disease. And in fact, we, in the near future, would like to put this representation into mathematical representation in order to, in fact, perturb in silico one such a biological system with a candidate drug from which we know the characteristics and predict as to whether it will bring this system to normality. And in fact, the normal set of molecular interactions is represented on the right-hand side on this slide. So this is really a new way to look at complex and chronic diseases. As I would say simple concluding remarks, I would like to emphasize that I think for us in the pharmaceutical industry, this is a revolution. And I would, in fact, speaking about AI, let us make a prediction. I would like to predict that in the 5 years from now, the way we will develop new drugs will be completely different, most particularly because there will be influence of AI at all the stages. And I would emphasize particularly the pre-validation in silico of therapeutic targets. This will help us being much more, productive with respect to developing new drugs. And from the patient perspective, and this is my second and last remark, I think that we're now heading towards an unprecedented level of understanding and knowledge about who he and she is with respect to her physiology, her disease, her relationship to the environment. And we can really compute all those information to head towards what I'm going to call a computational precision medicine. And I will stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Philippe Moijon. This is really exciting. And we can see how intelligence, artificial intelligence, takes a great place now in your studies and in the future, so within 5 years. And we talked about that a few minutes ago with attraction. We saw how intelligence and artificial intelligence had an important role set to play. So indeed, we are now excited. So maybe Christian Nieri, you are founder of Biogemics Pharma. What is your contribution in the project?
First of all, thank you for the opportunity to introduce Biogemics Pharma. I will explain our contribution. So Biogemics is a machine learning startup that is focused on our biological abilities to resist disease, to basically accelerate R&D for precision medicine. We basically address the two usual problems, that is to find the right target to drug for therapeutic precision, biological precision, and to find the right marker to develop for better patient stratification and better clinical trials. The way that we propose to do this is to exploit biological compensation. So in addition to the disease drivers, the risk factors that tend to accelerate the disease progression rate, there is always the importance of compensation mechanisms that repair our cells and make them resilient. The problem is that these mechanisms are cell type specific, time dependent, highly variable across patients, requiring the need for precision machine learning techniques to detect basically resilience over senescent state. And this kind of approach is particularly relevant to neurodegenerative disease, immune disorders, and metabolic disorders. So basically, we use our platform to analyze complex data sets from model systems or from human patients, and we generate models of disease resistance across patients where the right marker to develop is the one that separates resilient patients versus frail patients. We also generate models of cellular resilience over senescence, where the right target to drug is the one that can reinstate homeostasis, leveraging drug discovery, refining patient stratification, improving clinical trials, and where the aim is to reduce the time to market. So more specifically, we design a machine learning platform for precise problem solving, where we are not just using always the same method to analyze the data, but basically we select the right combination of mathematical formalisms. And on top of this, we include the use of a priori knowledge on molecular resilience over senescence using our proprietary database that is cell type specific and also disease specific. And the outcome of doing this is a strong reduction of data complexity, where the network model that you mentioned before are very small, and where we can detect hidden signals in rich data sets that still are usually limited in terms of their dimension, providing a robust basis for the key decisions that that Philippe mentioned before. So we have several proof of concept. This is one example of a five-time acceleration on target selection, where we analyze the data from Huntington disease, the largest multi-omic data set probably to understand neurodegeneration on a system level for drug discovery and marker discovery. Over the past 10 years, using the individual machine learning methods, the problem was that there was too many targets impairing key decision about target selection. So we designed an approach where we basically use multi-layer network inference, including a priori knowledge into model building, a priori knowledge on cell survival signaling. And basically that allowed us within 2 years, 2-3 years, to highlight the importance of a small network of regulators of genes that are important for the regulation of striatal of homeostasis, which is very important in Huntington disease. And again, these are data from mice. And we selected a target called P16, which is a major cellular senescence inducer. And we validated this target in human stem cell models. And today it's under preclinical evaluation. You may wonder, actually, if cellular compensation is important as a therapeutic target. And here I like to introduce a new method that we designed called the shape deformation analysis, where we analyze the multidimensional, multi-omics data, again from HD mice, including gene expression data and functional data. And the conclusion of the model is that the loss of compensatory response, not the aggravation of pathogenic mechanism, is the main driver of striatal neuron death in HD mice. And I'd like to refer you to a paper in eLife to learn more about how we reached that unexpected conclusion and how that could inspire basic research on other neurodegenerative diseases. Well, with that, I'd just like to acknowledge the team that is behind Biogemix Pharma. We are expert in machine learning, but also in biological validation and patient stratification as well. So that's a feature I think that is interesting here. And we have a strong scientific advisory board, as you can see here, and people again that cover the science and also the operations and the business.
Thank you very much, Christian. We'll have a few questions for you, of course, because your approach and the way you use your data and the deep learning approach, is everything you said is really interesting. And of course, we understood that you could gain a lot of time to target new markers and to deliver new drugs. So, of course, we understand now more and more why Philippe Moisjean said that this is a revolution for the next 5 years. Nathalie Sibylle from CNRS and INSERM at Montpellier University. You work at the Center for Structural Biology. You are going to talk about something very new for most of people, and you just quoted it, Christian Néry. We talked about unfolding structure of proteins. You work on the unfolded structure of proteins?
Yes.
So let's discover your science.
Okay, thank you very much. So good afternoon, everybody. I'm very pleased to be part of this very interesting hybrid initiative, and I would like to thank all the organizers of the meeting. As Philippe mentioned, I will talk about the impact of artificial intelligence in structural biology and drug discovery. So until the 19th, the golden rule in structural biology was that a well-defined three-dimensional structure is necessary for the function of the protein. So to better understand how a protein works and what it does, we need to determine its 3D shape. And to do that, we use three main techniques. Nuclear magnetic resonance, which defines a map of interproton distances and also gives access to the dynamics of the protein. X-ray lithography, which provides an electron density map if a crystal can be obtained. And cryo-electron microscopy gives a direct image of the molecule. And cryo-EM underwent a kind of resolution revolution 5 years ago and is now reaching atomic resolution. So finally, to the most suitable way to address macromolecules complexes that are composed of both folded and highly flexible part is to combine data from these complementary techniques that I've shown with computational modeling to deliver better models of the studied system. Last November, we discovered that Google has made a big step forward in the most important problem in structural biology, which is the so-called protein folding problem. Indeed, how a chain of aminoid fold into a well-defined 3D structure remains a big mystery. However, the DeepMind team in London and their AlphaFold artificial intelligence-based program somehow solved the problem. And indeed, they have participated to the CASP competition for critical assessment of protein structure prediction. It's a kind of Olympic game for molecular modelers that was started in 94 by John Mault. And something like 100 teams participate in this competition, starting from the same amino acid sequence. They predict a model that is compared to the experimental structure that remains secret until the end of the challenge. And in 2020, AlphaFold's structure predictions were close to the atomic resolved experimental structures. So I must say that it's quite impressive. It's a kind of a revolution for structural biologists. So briefly, how does AlphaFold work? So from a protein sequence, the algorithm uses what it has learned before to build a matrix of this between pairs of amino acids in the protein. And after several iteration steps, it comes up with a final model of what the protein should look like. And of course, AlphaFold can still be wrong, but we still have to verify the validity of the structure experimentally. But, it can turn into a big revolution for drug design. Indeed, in silico drug design is based on the 3D structure or the interaction surface between two proteins. We can do the parallel with the lock and key concept of an enzyme and its substrate. We need to reveal the shape of the protein or its active site in order to rationally design a drug that will fit the cavity or the interacting surface between the two partners. So we can anticipate that the time saved on determining the structure by AlphaFold 2 or AlphaFold will be to better design new drugs. However, However, we have to keep in mind that some complexes are completely fuzzy because they involve the highly flexible or intrinsically disordered protein. Here you have an example of a folded nuclear receptor in blue, which is regulated by coactivators or repressors that are natively completely disordered, as you can see in red. And in general, this kind of protein interacts via chimera motifs. Here in this structure, it's an helix in red. And these motifs possess transient secondary structure elements that fold upon binding to their partner. These motifs are often highly conserved and they encompass the functional part of the IDP. So why are these intrinsically disordered proteins so fascinating? IDPs are very common in eukaryotes, and they represent up to 50% of our genome, so it's not nothing. IDPs are very accessible to post-translational modification. And they can adapt to many partners by changing their structure. And in doing so, they can fine-tune the thermodynamics properties of the complex. So with all these general biophysical features, it's not surprising saying that IDPs are linked to very specific functions such as signaling, transcription, neurotransmission, and immunity. As a consequence, their deregulation is at the origin of a multitude of diseases such as cancer, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, and as well neuroinflammation, such as the tau protein that is involved in the Alzheimer disease or alpha-synuclein in Parkinson, and chronic inflammatory or autoimmune pathologies, such as chemokine or cytokine receptors. So to understand how these diseases appear, we have to understand their structural basis. And for drug design, some small molecules have already been used to target the folded part of this kind of complexes. But there is an important field of research for protein-protein interaction inhibitors where one of the partners is completely disordered. An example in cancer drug research is the inhibition of the P53 MD-M2 interaction. And as a conclusion, I would like to emphasize that integrative structural biology is required to study complex systems. AlphaFold is a kind of revolution for in silico drug design. Structural diversity and flexibility have to be taken into account because IDPs are in turn hurt, so their loss is more likely to cause cellular death. And IDPs are classified as difficult to drug or yet to be drug. So we still not have a very rational applicable strategy. Therefore, we still have a large field open to artificial intelligence approaches for rational drug design targeting IDPs. Finally, I would like to thank all the people of my team that are involved in the different projects of the group. I would like to thank as well Philippe and you all for your attention.
Thank you very much, Nathalie Sibylle, for this incredible explanation and expression of this AlphaFold. We will have a few questions for you about AlphaFold because it sounds to be a real revolution for a structural biologist, as you said, and we will have probably curiosity to know more about it. But we have already a few questions from participants on the internet, so please carry on. If you have other questions, we have 20 minutes left to talk with our here, the speakers. So if you have some other questions for them, more than those I'm going to ask for you, don't hesitate, use your chat tool just at the bottom of the screen. I would have maybe a first question for you, Philippe Moinjean, because we go back to the beginning. And we were very interested by your overview of artificial intelligence and the progress, the revolution you said too, within 5 years from now, probably thanks to artificial intelligence. I'd like to know more about what we could call in silico trials and virtual patients. Is it possible to imagine everything virtual before going to real life?
Yeah, well, this is obviously a big question. First of all, I think artificial intelligence, by helping us to better understand the disease and the patients, will definitely help us in designing clinical studies. That's not exactly the answer yet to your question, but it's a first step. Mm-hmm. By this, I mean selecting the proper patient we want to include based on well-known characteristics. Of course, the stage we want to reach is truly virtual clinical studies, because this is where, you know, the cost is really the burden of the cost is the highest for the pharmaceutical industry. You've seen on the figures more than $2 billion on average to develop a drug. So there is a huge gain of I would say productivity here. And as of today, we can see that there are some attempts already to move in this direction. And in fact, we hear quite a lot about virtual placebo groups. And here, this is something you can already achieve as of today, because you're not treating the patient with your drug here. For example, if you deal with patients with cancer or with rare disease, for cancer, it's not ethical to in many circumstances, not to give a placebo. Right? So you are going to model at least part of the placebo group on the basis of known knowledge of the evolution of this cancer in patients with those characteristics. And this is already, I would say, on the table. The technology is there. Of course, the key question here is how the regulatory authorities will accept those data. As of today, the idea is rather to mix those data with real world data with placebo. Now, the question and what gets us totally excited is this virtual trials and virtual patients. And I think we are not there yet. I think what is missing is that the first of all, that we have more and more models of causality of the disease in the form of the biological systems, for example, I was showing. And then we need to validate those systems, those predictive models, I'm sorry, in the context of wet lab experiments. And this will take some time. But in my mind, there is no doubt that probably it will take more than the 5 years for this part. I would say in the decade, then we will see more and more, I would say, clinical studies where there are attempts to put at least some synthetic patients among the cohorts.
Okay, but anyway, at the very end, there will be real patients included in clinical trials to be sure that it works in real life.
Yes, I think you have to do that, but maybe you will have one real world clinical study for 10 virtual clinical studies prior to that.
Okay. That's the. So the idea is to reduce the chance and to get a greater success. So this is what you're doing, Christian Nieri. You're trying to do. You just explained us what you were attempting to do, but your methods, biogenomics methods, and your techniques, are they relevant for all types of data or disease?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, we are able to analyze any data types from molecular data, multi-omics data. We are able to integrate several levels of layers, several layers of molecular regulation into a consistent model. Of course, we can also analyze multimodal data where we have a mix of molecular data, biological data, and clinical data that are collected in patients, in human cohorts, and we want to make sense of the data in such a way that it's possible to identify what are the main determinants at the molecular level that can be used to predict the evolution of a disease process. So we can basically analyze any type of data, yes.
To go further in the same way, I've got a question by Benoit. It's kind of to reverse the question. What do you think are the threats that could prevent AI from delivering results?
Well, that's an interesting question, actually. I think that usually the focus is made on collecting more and more genetic and molecular data, whether it's in model systems or in human patients. But I'd just like to emphasize the importance of data quality in terms of what we can learn at the clinical level. The homogeneity of the clinical data, the rate of evolution of the disease when it is measured across a large number of patients, when it's part of a multicentric study, it's very important to ensure data quality. And that's where is basically, I think, an important criterion for us. If you have bad clinical data, and if you have a huge amount of molecular and genetic data, metabolomics, proteomics, whatever you can think of, I mean, no method will be able to find something. So the quality of the clinical data, especially if they are longitudinal, collected over time, is really key to a success of any exercise in which artificial intelligence, or more precisely machine learning, is used to discover new predictive markers.
In the same prospect, Philippe Moijan, you said that thanks to in silico clinical trials and virtual patients, you will gain time, money, before focusing on specific targets that will be the occasion of real clinical trial. But another way to wonder about this issue is the question by Lionel Le Bourris: how to use molecules that are useful for a subset of patients, but see their development stopped because deemed unprofitable. Could such AI approach rescue some targets by identifying patients?
Yes, I think so. And we can think of a very concrete example in terms of application, which is the design of drugs for rare diseases. Mm-hmm. By definition, you know, you may think that those drugs are very unlikely to be profitable in many circumstances because there are few patients with a given disease. And yet, if we make significant gains of productivity, in this case, you know, most particularly at the level of the clinical studies, right? If we can have part of the clinical studies being conducted in silico, I think, you know, it could certainly help to, I would say, solve the profitability issue, you might say, and certainly bring down the costs of those new drugs.
Thank you, Nathalie. Sibylle, are you still with
yes.
us?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I wanted to go back to this AlphaFold kind of revolution, the software that predicts the 3D structure of proteins from their amino acid sequence. Will it really change everything for you?
So for structural biologists, I think yes, because the structural determination is quite laborious and expensive. So it will enable to save time and money. Then for me, with intrinsically disordered protein, I think we still have time, but I'm sure that artificial intelligence will progress fast. Then I think that it will change the fact that it will help to solve the structure of protein that were unreachable until now for technical reasons. And it will imply less pipetting and more thinking, so it will change a lot of things, I think. Yeah.
I would make a strange comparison, but we all heard about the CRISPR-Cas9 revolution in labs. Would you say that AlphaFold and this kind of technologies would be as important for you?
It's quite similar. Yeah, it's a big thing.
Okay,
we'll see how it evolves.
Okay, so it's exciting. We can imagine how important it is for all of you, I mean, structural biologists especially. Another question, and I you can carry on asking your questions, as I said, on the tool, but just at the moment, I'm trying to find out the question because my tablet has gone down, so I will try to find the questions. No, it doesn't work anymore, but I think that I remember the question. Do you think that we have enough power in France to face, I would say, an international threat or international concurrence on these issues? It's a question for the two of you.
the strength of France again is the quality of clinical studies. The other strength is also, I think, the very high level of research in the field of mathematics and machine learning. So bringing that together in a more efficient manner should put us in a very good position to make progress with, you know, fighting disease and aging. Now there are maybe something also that is important, and this is basically our focus, that is to remember that anything about aging, anything about a disease process, engage two mechanisms. One is a risk factor, a pathogenic mechanism, but again, there is the key importance of what we call compensation and resilience when it is successful, and senescence when it is not successful. And to measure that would basically allow to come up with a better stratification of patients, for example, to design clinical trials that would be more efficient, smaller, and more successful. So all in one, I think that the science, the technology, and the concept in France, I think we are in a very good position to advance the field.
But is there enough money? Is there enough investment in companies like yours, for example, in France? Or do you go to find...
Money is there. Money is there. There are several mechanisms that have been implemented. And the BPI is one example, but there are other examples. So money is there, definitely. What is sometimes not so easy for startups, I guess, are the initial steps. And talking about a concrete field of R&D, I think the most critical step is early stage R&D. If you do a mistake at the stage of the early steps of R&D, then the consequences are huge. So you want to avoid that, and that's where we target our action at Biogemix Pharma. We target early stage R&D.
Okay, thank you, Christian. Philippe, the same question that I've got, it I would like to ask it exactly as it was written by Julien. Does France have a chance to succeed versus the powers of the world players in artificial intelligence?
Okay, I think the answer is clearly yes, and I fully agree with Christian, because first of all, we have, you know, very conceptual scientists. We have an excellent school in mathematics, modeling, computing. I mean, there are examples, companies like Hawking, for example, or Quinten, you know, are very well established, you know, as in a obviously a very competitive landscape. The second part, I think the second strength of France is, I think this government, and I'm thinking most particularly of Villani with his report, has identified health as an important strategic field for applying artificial intelligence, and thus I think it's very important for us in the pharmaceutical industry, and we have with our very unique health system a potential access to a lot of data. So I think yes, France, by the way, it will regulate hopefully the access to health data, plus supporting, really focusing resources, investing a lot on what is seen as a strategic area, has a chance to succeed. I will put just one little grain of salt. I think what is very important for the French mindset is to evolve a little bit, because in this new area, I was talking about computational precision medicine. By definition, we need to bring together people who are, I would say, living on different scientific planets. And it has not necessarily always been the strength in our country relative to what, for example, Americans do. I think Americans can very easily relate, even if they come to a problem with different perspectives. So if we in France, and why not, you know, we are able to come with a proper mindset to go and understand computational scientists if you're an MD or a biologist, and vice versa if you're a computer scientist, then I think, you know, we will win a few battles.
Thank you very much for the three of you, Philippe Moijon, Christian Néry, Nathalie Sibylle, for these presentations and this overview, this transversal vision of artificial intelligence. And as you said, we're on the verge of a real revolution in the next few years. So it was really exciting to listen to you. Thanks a lot for your participation. Thank you very much.